Good afternoon. I'm Don Fry, Chairman of the Video Lottery Facility Location Commission, and I've called the meeting to order. The role of the Video Lottery Facility Location Commission is to evaluate the proposals that are submitted for a gaming facility in Prince George's County. We previously have awarded a license in 5 other locations in the state. We evaluate those proposals and then we award the license based upon a set of criteria that's set forth in the statute for us to follow. The commissioners are appointed, 3 from by the governor, one of which is the chairman, 2 from the speaker of the Speaker of the House, and 2 from the President of the Senate. Let me take a moment to introduce the members of the commission to you. To my far left is Commissioner Mike Miller. Seated next to Mr. Miller is Commissioner Linda Reed. To my immediate left is Commissioner Ella Pierce. To my far right is Commissioner James King. Seated next to Mr. King is Commissioner Renner Kramer. And seated immediately to my right is Jackie Vincent, who is the primary staff member responsible for our commission. We'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for coming out today. This is the second portion of today's program. We previously have had an opportunity to actually view the specific site which Parks is recommending for a casino. That gave us the opportunity to see firsthand the location, to see the surrounding community, to listen to an earlier presentation as to their vision for this gaming facility. This second section will provide us an opportunity to hear more details regarding the proposal and allow the commissioners to ask specific questions or details regarding those proposals as we see fit. We anticipate that this portion of the process will be approximately 1 hour. We will then take a break and then come back at 6 p.m., at which time we'll have the opportunity to hear from members of the public regarding the proposal. With that, let me ask Mr. Rickey if you would please to start off and maybe introduce your team and feel free to go ahead with the proposal. We may periodically be interrupting you to ask you specific questions or clarifications that you may have with your proposal. But we, again, on behalf of the state of Maryland, we thank you for your interest in gaming in the state of Maryland and appreciate your interest in this process.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, good afternoon, members of the commission, staff, friends and neighbors of Fort Washington and the surrounding communities, members of the press. My name is Tony Rickey. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of Greenwood Racing. We are the major shareholder in this project. To my right are our minority partners, Thomas Taylor and Ronnie Elam. And on behalf of our chairman, Bob Green, who's seated to my left, and our outstanding team, we're thrilled to be here today to present to you what we believe is the best proposal for the state of Maryland and the community. And now we'll tell you why. First slide. Our location is farthest removed from residential areas and offers the greatest opportunity to create additional economic development in the community. You visited our site today and you saw the tremendous potential that exists there, particularly when we discussed the highway improvements at Indian Head. We will create an elegant, preeminent national destination resort on a revitalized Indian Head Highway, and that will be integrated within the fabric of the community. Our world-class entertainment complex will complement the history and culture of Prince George's County, and our marketing efforts will attract visitors nationwide. Our proposal includes a public-private partnership to fund the desperately needed, long-planned but unfunded Indian Head Highway master plan improvements. Our ownership group includes prominent residents of Fort Washington, Maryland, the two gentlemen to my right. And we will invest $761 million into the project, and that will create 5,000 jobs and more than $600 million in economic output during the construction phase alone. Once operational, we will generate 5,700 jobs and $1 billion per annum of economic output for the state and the community. This does not include the benefit of the anticipated additional development in the area, which we are sure will come with our site as the hub for an economic engine. Next, we've proposed a 33% operator share on slot revenue, and we expect to generate approximately $500 million in annual gaming tax revenue at property maturity. This 33% share represents a 5% differential from the maximum authorized of 38%, and we estimate that that would provide the state approximately $30 million per annum of incremental tax revenue and approximately $450 million of incremental tax revenue versus the maximum level over the initial term of the license. We commit to bring prosperity to the community, and that includes local preference for jobs and vendor contracts, cross-marketing with local businesses, and support for education and charitable institutions, which is something that we practice in our Pennsylvania operation. Another important point for the Commission is certainty of execution. Our team has successfully implemented this program in Pennsylvania. We're the top operator in a high-tax jurisdiction in a major metropolitan area within the Mid-Atlantic region. It's very similar to the situation we have here. In addition, we have local partners who will help ensure that the community will realize the maximum benefit from our development. You can be sure that this project will be our top priority and it will receive our full attention. It will not be one of many in an international portfolio. And we have no operations in low-tax jurisdictions that would tempt us to drive business to a lower tax environment. On the contrary, we will use our 1 million member database in Pennsylvania to incent out-of-state visitation to our resort. And finally, it's highly unlikely that these benefits, particularly the highway improvements and the additional development that our site uniquely provides, will occur without our project as the economic engine. I would now like to introduce our minority owners in the project, two gentlemen I've known for almost 15 years. We've worked together to bring a first-class entertainment destination to this county. When the referendum passed in November, we knew our time had come, and we searched for a site, and we found that beautiful location you visited today at Old Fort Road and Indianette Highway, and we put together a fantastic plan. I'm very proud to call these gentlemen my partners, my friends, Mr. Thomas Taylor, Mr. Ronnie Elam.
Thanks, Tony. And thank Commissioner and guests who have come to support us in this effort. My name is Thomas Taylor. I lived here in Fort Washington for the last 30 years. As Tony has said, our relationship go back at least 15 years in trying to work together to bring about economic benefit to this county. And this opportunity, we feel, afford us this opportunity to be able to do that. As members of this committee know, in this community, know that we're in desperate need to unlock the key that holds this casino will bring to our community and the job that it will bring to our community. We are in so desperate in need of those jobs. So our primary focus is to see that the community gets their fair share of these jobs and the contract that this opportunity will afford them.
Good evening, Commissioner, and staff, and guests. As my partner said, we are here on this mission to ensure, Mr. Thomas and I are to ensure that our community benefit from this. We'd have had projects that come to our community before and said that they was going to do things for our community and it has not materialized. But we are here at this table here to make sure that our community benefits. Our location is by far the best location out of all of them if you look at the geographics of it. We have failing malls all around us. This casino at this site would be an economical engine that this community needs. With desperate need of engine. We have a beautiful car, but it's not going nowhere because we don't have an engine. Puff Casino, the reason we partner with Puff Casino is not just because they're good people, they're friends of ours, But the biggest thing, we saw the economic development they put in their own area. We see the success that the business have in the community has. We see churches around it, and we see growth. Everything that our community need, we need it. We need growth. We need opportunity. We need jobs. We have an opportunity here to give over 5,000 jobs to our community. We got construction. We got a lot of construction to be done. We got $800 million. A lot of it going to be done in construction in 2 years. We want to make sure that that money get infused in our community and don't leave our community. That is the reason why Mr. Thomas and I are here today. And that's why we beg and we plead of you all to support us in this effort to make sure that our community get what it deserves and what it's been waiting for over 30 years.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'd now like to give you some background on Greenwood Racing. We are the owner and operator of Parks Casino. Parks Casino is the number one casino in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania happens to be the state that generates the most tax revenue from casino gaming in the country. And our property generates as much tax revenue as Penn Gaming's top property, Charlestown. And we generate significantly more gaming tax revenue than any single U.S. property that MGM operates. We also own and operate Parks Racetrack, the number one thoroughbred track in Pennsylvania, the Atlantic City Racetrack, 6 off-track wagering locations in Pennsylvania and New Jersey, account wagering operations in Pennsylvania and Oregon, and we are a 50% joint venture partner with Penn National in Freehold Raceway, which is a harness racetrack in New Jersey. We boast a top-notch management team with extensive experience in the gaming industry, and they have long tenure with our company. We have very low turnover. The Parks brand is synonymous with a beautiful property that is well-maintained, clean, and safe. And we provide first-class service to our customers to create customer satisfaction and long-term loyalty. We are passionate about customer service. Our third-party customer surveys consistently rank Parks as the top customer service provider in our highly competitive market. This market includes 17 casinos within a 75-mile radius. It's a much less competitive environment here in Prince George's County. Now, this can only be achieved with a talented, motivated, and well-trained team. Our employees receive extensive training in both mandated areas and in customer service to ensure a consistent experience for our customers. And our firm has strong commitment to diversity, community outreach, and social responsibility. We take great pride in the recognition that we've received in these areas, and we understand that a strong, vibrant community provides an attractive destination for our customers. Parks has a long tradition of cooperation with local labor unions. All of our construction projects have been performed with union labor, and we have 16 different collective bargaining agreements with 12 different unions in our operations. We are highly respected within the banking community. Our shrewd financial management has gained us much respect and a very strong balance sheet. There is no doubt that we possess the necessary financial resources to complete this project. And I think it would be helpful for you to see for yourselves how beautiful our property is and to hear for yourselves from others how we conduct ourselves in the marketplace. So we prepared a video.
Greenwood Racing Incorporated, owners of Parks Casino, present Parks Casino Hotel and Spa, a development of Maryland Casino, LLC.
Hello, I'm Ed Rendell, the former mayor of Philadelphia and the former governor of Pennsylvania. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to tell you about my experience with Bob Green and the Park Racing and Casino team. It's been a great experience. I got to know Bob when I was mayor, but when I became governor, we instituted gaming throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And today, Pennsylvania makes more tax revenue from gaming than any state in the Union. And Parks has been a real big part of that. Over the years, they've contributed over $1 billion. That's right, over $1 billion in gaming taxes. They employ thousands of people, and they build a magnificent facility that we're all very, very, very proud of. But even better than all of that, they've been a great member of the community, a great contributor to so many charitable and community causes. So it's easy to see that Parks has been great for Pennsylvania, and given the opportunity, they'll be great for Maryland as well.
Parks Casino is the leading casino in Pennsylvania, located just outside of Philadelphia in Bensalem, Pennsylvania, on over 460 acres. Parks also houses Parks Racing, Pennsylvania's premier thoroughbred racetrack. The casino building has approximately 470,000 square feet of entertainment space and offers a full range of gaming amenities. Parks Casino offers 3,400 slot machines, including popular favorites. There is a luxurious high-limit slot room, exclusive, that offers high-denomination slot games. Parks also offers a wide variety of live table games, including blackjack, roulette, craps, and baccarat. With one of the most exclusive high-limit table game rooms in Pennsylvania, guests enjoy a special gaming enclave with a private lounge. The Parks Poker Room features 45 tables and is one of the top-grossing rooms in the U.S. Parks Casino's signature restaurant, the Parks Grill, is a tastefully designed steakhouse with excellent food and gracious service. Chickies and Pete's, the famous Philadelphia Crab House, which was named the number one sports bar in North America by ESPN, offers the freshest seafood and the world-famous crab fries. Upscale food court that offers burgers, hot dogs, and a wide variety of freshly made delicacies. Those looking for authentic Asian cuisine can find it at Parks at the San Key Noodle Bar. 360 is Parks Casino's high-energy entertainment hotspot, where sophistication meets after dark. Enjoy a signature cocktail and take center stage on our LED dance floor that pulsates to the beat of the music. 360 features the best live bands, the hottest DJs, and sensational live acts. Jack's Sports Bar, located in the center of the casino floor, offers video poker and live coverage of sporting events from around the world. Parks Casino has a history of working closely with the communities in which they develop and reaching out to maximize the participation in their projects by local, minority, and women-owned businesses. State and local township officials offer these positive endorsements of the Parks team.
They have done a great job for us here in Bensalem. They've been a great business partner, a great community partner. They have lived up to all of the things that they said that would happen here in Bensalem if a casino came. Most important thing here was the communities to make sure that the quality of life stayed the same for all of them, whether it be traffic or any other kind of problems that might arise. That has not happened here in Bensalem. We are very, very happy with the outcome, and we look forward to a great future with Parks Casino here. They have done a phenomenal job, and as a business partner, it's been great for our community. The people at Fort Washington, Maryland, we hope that you'll experience the same kind of environment that we've had here and the partnership with your community.
Since the arrival of Parks Casino in December 2006, they have been a great community partner. A lot of people thought that crime would be impacted due to Parks' casino's arrival. That has not been the case. As a matter of fact, Parks has been working with us constantly on a daily basis to make sure that crime and all the other emergency services are well taken care of and that they don't affect the residents of our townships. I couldn't imagine a better partner coming to Bensalem Township.
Parks Casino in Bensalem has been a great corporate partner. Parks has contributed over $16 million locally and well into $1 billion into the state economy. So it's just been a great success. They're involved in all our community activities, our Chamber of Commerce, our Rotary Clubs. They give to EITC programs and other charitable organizations. They give to our rescue squads. People love working here. It's been good for my community.
They have been a simply amazing neighbor. Almost 2,000 new jobs, or well-paying jobs with benefits, and also the spin-off effect that they've had on the economy in the surrounding area. So it's just been a win-win-win between the casino and our community here in Bensalem Township. And just to close, Money Magazine voted Bensalem Township in 2012 one of the 100 best places to live in the United States of America, not just in Pennsylvania, in the United States of America. And I think Parks Casino had a lot to do with making that happen.
Parks works closely with local community organizations to develop a strong, vibrant region.
I just want to report to you what a great and phenomenal partner that Parks has been with the Lower Bucks business community. They really outreach to products and services to come from local businesses and give the local business community first dibs on applying for those contracts. It's been a huge economic engine to this part of the community.
They have been one of the best partners that we have in Bucks County. We benefit by the the tremendous amount of people that come into the area, into Bucks County, and it's been very beneficial for both parties.
Parks is also proud to support a wide variety of local and national organizations.
Parks have expressed a sincere partnership with us here in Bucks County, and along with that partnership, they have become substantial contributors to our branch as we continue our efforts to educate the community, and we are so grateful to them for that.
We're extremely happy to endorse Parks Casino for their support of the United Negro College Fund. Last year, we came to Parks Casino to support our signature event, the Mayor's Masked Ball. Parks jumped in immediately and gave their support. Not only did they give their support financially, they went out and secured additional funding for the United Negro College Fund. So Parks Casino, thank you so much for being one of the first ones to stand up, raise your hands, roll up your sleeves.
Parks Casino has been there to support the American Red Cross around the world with their support of Haiti and the hurricane victims, around the country with their support of the Oklahoma tornado victims, and around the corner with their support of those victims right here in Bucks County from Superstorm Sandy.
Parks also has long-standing relationships with local trade unions.
We represent over 5,000 electricians and technicians. For over 20 years, we've had a business relationship with Parks Casino. They are people who you can trust. They are not only honest business partners, okay, but they're our partners in the community too. Philanthropically, they're as good as anybody we do business with. Okay, the programs they offer for their workers are outstanding, their benefits are fabulous, and they do a great job.
The Parks team is looking forward to developing an exciting national destination that is deeply woven into the fabric of the community. Together, we will prosper.
As you can see, we have a very beautiful property. It gives you a sense of what we intend to bring, as Tom O'Connor showed earlier in the site visit. For those who don't know, Bensalem Township is literally on the Philadelphia city line, where our property is situated approximately 1 mile from the Philadelphia city line. So we really are part of a major metropolitan area. And I think what you can see from those testimonials, we live what we preach. You wouldn't get the head of the electricians labor union to come out and support you unless you did. He's a tough guy. I'd now like to move to the next segment of the review, which is the project review, and start with our location highlights. And we visited the site today, and as I said, we love our site. It has excellent highway access with close proximity to the Capitol Beltway. It offers the least impact on residential areas of the three proposals, and with us as the economic engine, it offers tremendous potential for additional development that we don't see how that could come with the other proposals. And I'd like to speak to that a little further. The next slide is an aerial photo of the National Harbor development. As you can see, it's surrounded by a residential community, completely surrounded. There's no room for additional development there, and it clearly has some impact on the residential community there. The next slide shows the MGM site in relation to National Harbor and the Tanger Outlets. And again, you see there's quite a distance between MGM and the harbor site. It's not integrated within that development. It's quite a hike. I doubt people are walking it. And you again see that you have a residential community completely surrounding that area. Doesn't offer much opportunity for additional economic development. The next slide is the Rosecroft site. Again, that's bordered by two substantial residential communities on both sides. The next one is an aerial photo of our site. These are all the same scale, no trick photography. Our site is the rectangle in the center of the slide. And you can see there, it's very difficult to find any substantial residential development in the area, which is really what drew us to this site in the first place. And it's ripe for development. We can transform that entire commercially zoned area to the north of our site with our location, our project as an economic engine, creating development potential, driving traffic and visitors into that area. And as you saw from the video, the way we reach out to the community, include them in the benefits of the development. And when you put that in conjunction with the Indian Head Highway improvements, I think it makes a very, very powerful, persuasive point. The next item on our project review, we felt we would walk through our project and demonstrate to you how our proposal satisfies the objectives that were laid out in the statute with the evaluation criteria, starting with how our proposal provides the highest prospective total revenues to the state. We offer the maximum number of slot machines, 4,750, which will generate the highest possible gaming revenue and therefore highest possible gaming tax revenue to the state. In conjunction with that, we've submitted a license fee of $28.5 million, which is the largest that's been submitted. Our 33% operator share of the VLT gaming revenue provides a significant incremental gaming tax versus the 38% maximum authorized. As I noted earlier, we believe that would be more than $450 million of incremental tax revenue to the state during the initial license term. And we project total gaming taxes of $2.4 billion for the first 5.5 years of operation, with more than $500 million of gaming taxes per annum thereafter. We will create 4,921 new permanent jobs at parks alone, and that will include more than $120 million in annual wages, along with the best benefit package in the regional gaming industry, in conjunction with our program to make sure our employees are talented, motivated, and highly engaged so that they do deliver great service. We reward them and compensate them well. We will create 5,000 construction jobs and $626 million of economic output during the construction phase. Overall, 5,700 new permanent jobs will be created, along with $1 billion of annual economic benefit to the state and the community on an ongoing basis. And last point, since the topic is maximizing revenue to the state, we have no temptation to drive business to significantly lower tax properties. Our property is in a state with a comparable level of tax in Pennsylvania, and as I said earlier, our motivation would be more to drive business to this area. The next element is the proposed revenues based on a market analysis. A market analysis was prepared by Christensen Capital Advisors, and it estimates that the total market demand to be $1.3 billion for our site. They then concluded and prepared projections for our hotel and spa in year three, the third full year of operation, and they gave three ranges: a high range of $1.02 billion, a moderate range of $916 million, and a low range of $812 million. In our projections that we filed with the commission for year four, which is the year 2020, we assumed the low case for conservatism on slot revenue and the moderate case on table games, because we do feel more bullish on that side, and also because it has less impact on tax revenues, and we would prefer to exceed expectations than disappoint. And this generates a total of $843 million of gaming revenue, and that serves as the basis for the aforementioned gaming taxes that I described earlier. In addition, there will be $103 million of annual revenue anticipated from food and beverage, hotel, and entertainment operations. The next slide.
Mr. Rickey, these projections by Christensen were based upon the 4,750 machines that you've submitted for, is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you.
The next slide details our projections for the 5.5 year period commencing July 2016. And as you can see, in the first year and a half, we begin with 3,000 slots. Due to that being the maximum level that we were authorized, we weren't certain as to when we should assume that the incremental machines would be available to us. So we've ramped it up to have 4,750 slot machines in the year 2019. And as you can see in the year 2020, as I said earlier, our total gross revenue is $843 million. We have $2.4 billion of gaming taxes that are paid to the state during that 5.5-year period. And as you can see in year 2021, the total gaming taxes amount to $500 million. And I would note that, again, during that 5.5-year period, due to the fact that we're proposing a 33% share versus the 38% share that's the maximum authorized, that generates an incremental $163 million of tax revenue due to that differential during this period. The next criteria item is how we will encourage Maryland gaming participants to remain in the state. Well, the elegant casino, hotel, and spa that we will create will be a national tourist destination, and the amenities that we will offer will enable us to easily compete with other properties out of state and keep customers here in state. Our casino will include a very spacious casino, and it will incorporate cutting-edge technology. It will have 4,750 slot machines, 120 table games, and a beautiful poker room with 50 tables, which will enable us to serve the demand in the market. We will have an upscale hotel, world-class entertainment venue, along with branded restaurants and bars. So this will not only encourage Maryland residents to remain in the state, but will enable us to recapture revenue that is currently lost to West Virginia and Delaware. Our innovative marketing programs and superior customer service will help provide long-term loyalty. And again, since we're talking about keeping Marylanders in the state, we have no properties in low-tax jurisdictions that could encourage a feeder program to those lower-tax jurisdictions. Fourth criteria item, the extent that the proposed location demonstrates to be a substantial regional and tourist destination. We believe the combination of the property amenities and the marketing initiatives that we will review later in the presentation will serve to achieve this objective. The fifth item, capital construction plans and competitiveness of the proposed facility. Again, our world-class design, scale of this project, and we will present this in more detail later, will more than satisfy this goal. Item six, gross revenues allocated to the operator. We propose a 33% share of the VLT revenue and an 80% share of table games revenue. Seventh item, percentage ownership of MBE. We have two minority owners to my right. They have a total of 9.9% ownership. Mr. Taylor and Mr. Elam each own 4.95%. The eighth item, the extent to which the proposed location will preserve existing Maryland jobs and the number of net new jobs, we will create on our own at Parks 4,921 net new permanent jobs. At least 85% of them will go to Maryland residents, and at least 65% will be for individuals who live within 10 miles of our property. In total, there will be 5,700 net new permanent jobs in the region. Item nine, the applicant's plan to achieve minority participation goals. 40% of construction employees of construction will be MBE participation, and 35% of the casino vendors during the construction phase will be MBE and LBE. Upon commencement of our operations, we propose a minimum of 40% of our employees as women, minimum 35% minority, and a minimum of 35% of our vendors will be MBE and LBE, and a minimum of 15% women business enterprises. These targets significantly exceed the existing state and county goals, and our diversity plan has specific action plans to replicate our experience in Pennsylvania, where we have exceeded our targets. The next item, anticipated wages and benefits for new jobs. During the construction phase, we will create 4,926 jobs with associated annual labor income of $287 million. For ongoing operations at the casino, as I noted earlier, we will generate 4,921 new jobs more than $120 million in annual wages, and the employees will receive an above-market health benefits package. The total new job creation will be 5,694, with an estimated $190 million of ongoing annual wages as a result of our project. The next item is additional development planned in the area of the proposed facility. Our proposal is to form a public-private partnership with the state to implement the planned highway improvements for Indian Head Highway at the Livingston-Palmer and the Old Fort Road interchanges. These have long been part of the master plan for that road, and we commit to provide 50% of the funding up to a maximum of $100 million to accomplish this goal. The combination of these highway improvements and our entertainment resort as an economic engine will spur significant incremental development and investment into this area. And as Chris mentioned in the site visit earlier, our area has been designated for commercial development previously as part of the Henson Creek development plan. So we are tying into those existing programs. The next criteria item, the existing transportation infrastructure. Our property enjoys excellent highway access from I-495 and 295 via Indian Head Highway. There's mass transit available via multiple bus lines. We intend to provide shuttle buses for major attractions in the area to alleviate some of the pressure on traffic. And we will endeavor to connect the shuttle bus to National Harbor and the water taxis from Alexandria and Washington, D.C. And we will coordinate with the county, the local transportation authority, to connect to the planned Branch Avenue and Livingston-Palmer bus stations. Next criteria item, negative impact on the surrounding residential community. And we, as I showed you in the photos, we believe our resort has the least impact of the three applicants on a residential community. There are no residential neighborhoods surrounding our site. And our property is adjacent to a commercially zoned area that's ripe for development. Next item is the need for public infrastructure expenditures. There will be none required for our project. Our site has sufficient utility services, and any additional required utility, water or sewer, or traffic improvements will be the responsibility of Parks. And lastly, I'd like to note that our design program incorporates significant environmental sustainability features that Chris Heger of Langen will detail later in the presentation. That concludes my project review. Our next presenter will be Mr. Sebastian Sinclair. He's the president of Christensen Capital Advisors, and he will present the gaming market analysis and the economic impact analysis that we used as the basis for our projections.
Mr. Ricky, if I could, let me stop at that time. Maybe members of the commission may have some specific
Sure.
questions regarding the project analysis that you just placed before us, and then we can move forward to the market analysis,
of course.
If you'll mind. Members of Commissioner Reed?
Thank you. For the project review, in two places you mentioned no temptation to drive business to significantly lower tax properties, and then also no properties in a low tax jurisdiction to encourage feeder programs. Could you please expand or expound on those two statements and explain to me exactly what you're talking about?
Sure, and
Thank
I think
you.
It's an important consideration for the commission. Tasked with ensuring that the revenue to the state of Maryland is maximized when an operator has a property in another jurisdiction that has a 6% tax rate and your jurisdiction offers a minimum of a 62% tax rate on slot revenue and 20% on table game revenue, there's clearly a temptation there to drive business toward that lower tax market if you're a for-profit operator. It's undeniable. I'm not making any allegations or assertions, but it's clearly a consideration that is out there. And I do know that, you know, there are properties that do that in my experience.
And how would that be accomplished?
You develop a database in a certain market, and you market to that database and offer them incentives to come to your properties in other jurisdictions.
Thank you. You mentioned that you felt more bullish on table games versus slots. How does that square with your proposal to base your evaluation on a much higher number of slots compared to the other proposals? And with the number of proposals, with the number of slots ultimately supported by the market, pretty much be the same across all three properties?
I can't speak to how the other properties approach this. What I can say is we are very bullish on this market. In our experience in Pennsylvania, we exceeded our projections that we presented to the Gaming Commission back in 2006. We understand the Mid-Atlantic region very well, although we're not located specifically in this area. We're not far away. And we understand how a major metropolitan area works. Customers do have other choices for entertainment as opposed to a destination location. And I recognize we want to make this a destination, but recognize a lot of this business is going to come from the Washington, D.C. metro area, from Virginia, and maybe West Virginia, and south into North Carolina. Those people in the D.C. metro area do have other choices for entertainment. We have that same phenomenon in our market, and we understand how to market in that environment, particularly in a high-tax jurisdiction, and how to drive revenue. As I said earlier in the presentation, we operate in a very competitive market. There are 17 casinos within 75 miles. We do not have a level playing field because 13 of those casinos are in Atlantic City with a 9% tax rate. We are in Pennsylvania with a comparable tax rate to what you have here in Maryland. And we operate very successfully in competing with those properties because we know how to market and we know how to give great service. The property only comes to life because of the employees. The games are inanimate objects. We need employees to bring life and soul and energy to the property. So the combination of those factors and our assessment of this market is that there's huge potential that I don't know if the other operators see it, but we see it there. And in order for us to achieve these revenue objectives, we need 4,750 slot machines. The reason I went with the low case and the projections, as I mentioned earlier, is we prefer to exceed expectations, as we did in Pennsylvania, than to disappoint you with higher projections that we don't achieve. On the table game side, we were a little more bullish because we actually do feel there's less of an impact to the state if we're off on that one, given its 20% tax rate. But we also feel very strong about that. And frankly, internally, we would go for the moderate case on slots to try to achieve that. And we would need all 4,750 games to do that.
Commissioner Kramer.
Thank you. Do you have percentages of anticipated revenues from surrounding jurisdictions? Have you broken down your anticipated revenues by jurisdiction?
I don't believe we did that internally. Sebastian, did you do that in your market analysis? I don't recall.
Yeah, well, it's part and parcel of the way that we construct the models. I don't have that information off the top of my head, but yes, we do have it, because what we're looking at is by zip code, by market area, this zip code spends X, whatever it is, 20 million, 30 million. So we can break those numbers out. I just don't have them.
It's in the analysis, isn't it?
Yeah. Well,
and that analysis was filed with our application.
But so we could get an idea of how much business you anticipate to be bringing from Washington, D.C. and Virginia?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Thank you. I'll look forward to seeing that.
Yeah. Mr. King?
On your taxes, the gaming taxes. Can you speak to how you have broken down per slot, per table game, per poker table? Can you just speak a little bit how you generate those numbers, how you come to those numbers?
How do we generate the numbers?
I mean, how do you come to the difference between a slot machine, the table game, the poker table, and your forecast?
Well, we based our revenue and demand projections on the analysis that Christensen Capital prepared, and our own internal sense of this market also. We conducted the same process when we opened our casino in Pennsylvania. When we looked at it, we saw the demand based on our own internal experience. We have a good sense of how many tables and how many slot machines you require to meet that demand. And that's how we developed these programs. So these conform to what our experience is in Pennsylvania, because this is a less competitive market than Pennsylvania. We do believe that we can actually beat some of these numbers we have here.
Mr. Miller?
Two questions. The acreage of the site here in Maryland, how does that compare to the footprint of your site in Philadelphia, both in terms of what's developed and what you have for growth?
It's much smaller. Our site in Philadelphia is 460 acres, but that is a thoroughbred racetrack, which it houses over 1,400 horses on the property, too, and the one-mile oval racetrack and the grandstand. So it's probably apples and oranges in that sense. As we mentioned in the site visit, we're only utilizing 11 acres in the footprint of this 26-acre parcel we now own or control, so that we have more than enough space here to accomplish these goals.
So where would we look to see a casino of the magnitude and success that you intend here that is on a parcel as small as your parcel here? Where would we see that?
You would see it in Atlantic City or Las Vegas, because land is very, you know, rare there. Absolutely.
Okay, thanks. My other question is that you talked about your targets for hiring, and you mentioned 35% target for minority hiring.
Yes.
If you're going to emphasize hiring people from Prince George's County, wouldn't that number be somewhat low?
I agree. And these are minimum targets, as I mentioned in the presentation. Our goal, as Thomas and Ronnie referred earlier, we do intend to make sure that the community benefits. That is our theme of this proposal, and we want the community to benefit and develop, because we understand that for us to succeed and maximize the potential of this opportunity, that whole area, if that whole area thrives, we'll all rise together.
Okay, but you recognize that by committing to 35%, you're not committing to be representative of the immediate area. Is that, or does that seem
That's
right?
A fair point.
Okay.
And we will exceed that.
Mr. Rickey, in your chart that you showed a ramping up from 3,000 machines up to 4,750 machines to achieve the maximum revenue generation, as I understand it. If the commission were to authorize or award a license for 3,000 machines, is the facility still financially viable at 3,000 machines rather than just the 4,750 in the long term?
Well, it wouldn't generate as much revenue to the state, for sure. You could say it would be viable, but there would be lost opportunity and probably dissatisfied customers, because you would have less capacity than demand. And again, a lost opportunity for the state. But we could make it work if we had to.
Thank you. Mr. Kramer.
How much of your Philadelphia business do you feel comes from the synergy with racing?
Very little.
Could you explain that?
Yes, we have a database, and there is very little crossover between horse racing and casino gaming. We've studied that. It was something we were very interested to learn when we opened in 2006, because when we first opened, the casino was actually in the racetrack grandstand. So one of our floors was for racing customers, the other two were for casino gaming customers. We started, just like Maryland did, with only slot machines for the first couple of years. And we expected more. We were somewhat surprised to find that there was very little crossover between the racing customer and the slot customer in particular. Where we do see some crossover, but not much, is between the racing customer and the poker customer. They do seem to have common interests, but that's about it.
And how does it affect the hotel business and the entertainment business that you also have on the same site?
We have an entertainment business on the site. We do not have a hotel on our site. And one of the reasons for that, as I referred earlier to the Atlantic City competitive environment, Atlantic City made it economically unfeasible to open a hotel in our market with our tax rate, because what they've done is they're just giving away comps to everybody. They're giving, literally throwing money at people to go down there. We can't compete on that basis with somebody on a 9% tax rate. Customers at this point, and that's one of the reasons why we feel that we have an opportunity with this location. This is a different situation. You don't have that Atlantic City competitive environment, but we know we have customers that continue to go to Atlantic City on the weekend. They go less frequently than they used to before we opened, but we believe we have an opportunity to offer them something here with this beautiful resort, still be part of the park's umbrella, and take a visit to this area is a wonderful area. There's much to do. Our resort's very good, and we can offer them something as an alternative to Atlantic City. But for us, it just doesn't work. None of the casinos in our area have a hotel because of the Atlantic City phenomenon.
Thank you.
Just one last question. Could you describe or have someone on your team describe the actual current status of the zoning at this particular location?
I think I would refer that to Chris Hegger of Langen. He's our civil engineer. Chris, do you want to take that?
Yeah, well, the question was the
zoning status
of the site.
Our yes. site.
The site as it currently exists.
You want to take it, Lee?
Yeah, I don't mind taking it. I'm Lee Williams. Thank you. I'll answer the question if you might. Right now, the site is rural residential. It does develop. It does abut the developed tier, which is right across the street where you witness the McDonald's and the commercial zone, which is a CSC, commercial shopping center. And during the process, as you well know, is that the local district council for Prince George's County will take a look at legislation to create a zone for a new entertainment destination zone.
Thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
I think we can move forward to marketing now. Thank you very much. Appreciate your
accommodating
us with this question.
My pleasure. The next presenter is Mr. Sebastian Sinclair.
Good afternoon, and thank you for letting me come down here to speak with you today. If you're not familiar with our firm, we are a small consulting firm, and we do feasibility, market analysis, market assessments, and economic impacts for gaming companies and for state governments. We don't work in any other industries. So this is what we do on a daily basis. We were contacted by Parks this spring before they filed their application to provide an independent assessment of the revenue potential and the economic impact of their project. And this slide here describes the methodology that we use in detail. I won't bore you with all the details, but essentially we use a gravity model. We look at population and per capita income, driving distance and driving times from each market, which we define by zip code, to the subject location. Moving on, if I can, just I like to have pictures to just give a little sense of. We show the various casinos in the market within a 90-minute drive time. And as you can see, there isn't a whole lot to the south. The Parks Maryland site is close to the Virginia border, and as you know, currently, and for the at least for the near term, there aren't any casinos in Virginia. Now, this goes a little bit to the question that was asked earlier. This is our spending estimates by area, and we've imported these into MapPoint. The darker green indicates where most of the spending is coming from. Unfortunately, the software isn't very sensitive in terms of how you can actually slice it up. But as you can see, the vast majority of the market is coming from this area south of the park's location, partly into DC, and then as you move further away, as you get closer to other facilities, those revenues from those areas taper off. So as I said, although it doesn't completely answer the question, as you can tell by from the map, that the vast majority of the business for the site is coming from Virginia and the district. And as I think Tony already presented, when we conducted our analysis, we constructed a high, low, and moderate case. And what we found is that at this site location that the revenue could range from $812 million to approximately $1 billion. Secondly, we're utilizing our revenues as a base and also some food and beverage revenues and hotel revenues and provided by parks. We constructed an economic impact analysis of this facility. When we construct economic impact analysis, we use a software program called Implan. It's pretty common within the industry. There are others, such as RIMS and REMI. We prefer Implan because it allows us to alter these inputs and outputs to better reflect casino economics, for instance. Just to take an example, casinos are included within what's called amusements and other recreation, which is just this general classification in the national income and product accounts. It also includes bowling alleys, it also includes video arcades, so it doesn't specifically address the economics of a casino business. For instance, if you were to just to take a basic implant model and punch in casino A, $500 million, you would get employee numbers that you would not find in any casino market in any country or in any state, because casinos are very efficient revenue generators per employee, unlike bowling centers and arcades and so on and so forth. So we have to modify those models for casino gaming to better reflect the actual economics of casino gaming. And the next slides present the result of that analysis. And again, I think Tony has shown a lot of this in the previous slides. We estimate that the total employment, including the spillover effects or multiplier effects as they're called sometimes, would be 4,926 employees and $625.8 million of output during the construction phase. Now, it should be noted that's a one-time fee because it only incurs during the actual construction of the facility. And finally, we took the casino, the hotel, the food and beverage, and all the revenue centers, and we also generated an economic impact model of the operations of the facility on an annual basis. And what we found is that we project that the total employment in this, I should back up a little bit. Notice we say net total in terms of the economic impacts. One of the things that we do is we follow research on this industry on continuously, and we rely on some studies by others to assess, for instance, food and beverage. As I'm sure you've heard, there's an ongoing debate within the industry of how much food and beverage at a casino enterprise cannibalizes food and beverage at other locations in the area. And what we do is we try to adjust for that. And we use a net figure. So for instance, if where Tony was projecting, say, $75 million in food and beverage revenue, we would reduce that probably to like 45 or 50 to reflect the substitution and displacement effects associated with gaming. And so that said, the final result is that we project that on an annual basis, that employment will be 5,694 individuals and a total economic impact of just over $1 billion per year. Thank you.
Thank you, Sebastian.
Commissioner Reed.
Your employment figures, are they full-time equivalents or are they jobs?
They're jobs, so it counts part-time as well.
Thank you.
Mr. Rickey, please move forward. The only thing I'd indicate is we're probably about halfway through, and I know that you've got a very impressive set of documents before us.
I understand, and I do commend
you for going through the various factors that we have to do in our evaluation. I think it's very helpful for us to see that, and appreciate that very much. But just to be cognizant of the time, and just maybe if you could,
thank you. We'll pick up the pace.
Good. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I'm Mark Oppenheimer. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer for Greenwood Racing, and in the interest of time, I will be brief in giving you an overview of the marketing plan for Parks Casino Hotel and Spa. As I'm sure you'll agree with us, we believe that the marketing plan is critical to making sure that the numbers that we've talked about already today do actually come to happen and that we're able to deliver on the tax revenue that we're promising to the state of Maryland. What I want to do with you first and mainly is go through a series of five objectives as to what we're looking to achieve with our marketing plan. The first three are very high-level objectives. The last two start to get into strategies and tactics. First, as we've touched on, we will create a world-class national entertainment destination that also happens to be fully integrated within the community, and there will be marketing aspects to allow that to happen. The two most important objectives beyond that: we want to drive incremental gaming revenue into Maryland from the DC metro area, Virginia, and other regional and national population bases. At the same time, we want to recapture the gaming revenue that's currently leaving the state of Maryland, traveling to West Virginia or to Delaware or to further areas beyond that. On a slightly lower level, we plan to partner with the well-known attractions and community icons to create local, regional, and national awareness. Obviously, both on the Maryland side as well as the Washington, D.C. side, there are many possible opportunities for us to partner with and do joint marketing to drive people to the Parks Casino. And, obvious objective of any marketer, create trial visits, that first visitation, and then foster loyalty through the program. If we move to the next slide, how are we going to do this? Three core fundamental strategies that will take place. First, we need to get that awareness of the property. We'll do that via advertising, partnerships, and sponsorships. Second, we need to provide our guests with reasons to visit. And third, provide them with rewards and incentives via loyalty marketing, rewards being what we will give them for the revenue that they give us immediately, incentives being what we will give them in the future to bring them back to our property later. And as a question was asked earlier, it's this type of incentive marketing that could allow someone to take a database, whether it be a national database and pull them into Maryland, or a Maryland database and pull them out of Maryland. That is standard practice within the industry. Getting into a little bit of detail, how are we actually going to drive awareness of Parks Casino Hotel and Spa? The majority of this, a large piece of it, will need to be pre-opening in the buildup to a mid-2016 opening. Many ways we'll do this. One, very simple, partnering with the community, working with those that Ronnie and Thomas would put us in touch with, working with others that we'll reach out to set up kiosks, to set up sign-up places, to get people involved and a part of being a guest of Parks Casino, with regional tourism bureaus, with local attractions, gathering places, malls, businesses, all those things throughout the whole metro area, both in DC, in Maryland, and in Virginia. We'll also go public. Website messaging, Facebook messaging, mass advertising to promote the opening and beyond the opening. Database messages to our own regional and national gamblers, as well as the potential to reach out to regional and national gamblers that may not currently be a member of the Parks family, but that we can have access to. And then finally, promotion through a network of independent reps that we'll have access to around the country that would be able to represent Parks Casino Hotel and Spa in Maryland and bring gamblers from around the country to the destination resort that we will have here. Once we open, we then get into general advertising and partnerships. Our advertising, as you saw from the market assessment, will be focused mainly on the DC metro area, lower Maryland, and then states heading south and west, such as Virginia, West Virginia, and North Carolina, as we believe that will be the bulk of the market for the Prince George's County property. We also, though, will do national advertising in known gambling media. Our campaign will be focused on being an entertainment destination locally for the local community, and then as you move beyond that for the national community, and that campaign will be built by the same team that created the campaign that just won the American Gaming Association's award for the best campaign in the gaming industry, and that's our Get Lucky in No Time campaign that we're currently running at Parks Casino in Pennsylvania. The local advertising then will transform over into promotional advertising. As we've been open for a while, people are aware of us. We'll need to tell them what's going on, tell them what we're doing at the property, both from a gaming and a non-gaming perspective, and that's how the advertising will transition. Moving to the next slide, very quickly. We'll partner with others in the community to create visitor experiences that will drive visitation regionally and nationally. This will be partnering with the DC, Maryland, and Virginia Tourist and Visitors Bureaus to create tourist destination and entertainment trips where people come to Parks Casino to gamble and also take advantage of the other tourist opportunities within the metro area. In order to help facilitate that, we also, as Tony mentioned earlier, will run water taxis and shuttles from DC and Alexandria, as well as a full-time shuttle between us and the National Harbor Hotel properties. Some partnerships. We will leverage our Pennsylvania database. As Tony mentioned, we have nearly, or actually now more than 1 million accounts in the Pennsylvania database. We will happily market to them that a destination property is opening, because as Tony touched on, our Pennsylvania property is not a destination property. We do not have a hotel there because of those market dynamics. We will be able to provide them an opportunity, instead of going to Atlantic City or elsewhere, stay within the Parks family and come to Prince George's County on their weekend or getaway destinations. We will also partner and create a community partners program, which we have active in Pennsylvania now, that will work with local businesses and attractions to establish cross-marketing opportunities and establish deals for local and regional guests of our property. And we'll be a good partner with the community via sponsorships, whether it be sports teams, events, venues, attractions, charitable organizations, throughout our entire local and regional market area. Moving on, the second thing that I mentioned that we'll need to do is provide people reasons to visit. Thankfully, our property will do that in and of itself. We will be able to provide a full calendar of casino events and promotions, both for the local community as well as VIP guests. We also have the full calendar of non-casino gaming activities using our hotel, our upscale spa, world-class entertainment and nightlife, and the multiple venues that Tony has mentioned, as well as the 3,000-seat arena or event center that we will have, and all of our bars and restaurants will be brand-name bars and restaurants that will drive people to the property because of their ability to pull people in. Then finally, the last point on the marketing plan is the loyalty marketing side. As I mentioned here, there are two segments to this, really three, but two main. Provide rewards for current play via our X Club loyalty program, which is the key to one of the main pieces of the Parks brand. That X Club loyalty program would be integrated between gaming and non-gaming amenities at this property, and it would reward the loyalty via comps, free play, and other things for any dollar that is spent within the Parks Casino Hotel and Spa. Additionally, we'll provide incentives via the database marketing strategy to grow the share of wallet of our players. Once we get them in the first time, we'll start to learn about them and we'll develop that relationship over time through incentive marketing. And then finally, as I touched on earlier, we'll have national reach to our gamblers, both through our existing database and other databases we can have access to, as well as a network of independent reps that will sell the combination of Parks Casino Hotel and Spa, with Prince George's County and the D.C. metro area tourist attractions. In the interest of time, I'm going to wrap up on that, but I'm happy to take questions now or later.
Any questions by members of the commission? Thank you very much. I think you did a great job getting through that in a
Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you, Mark. Our next presenter is Mr. Tom O'Connor, who you met at the site visit. He's a principal with Sosh Architects. And, Mr. Chairman, I think we can make a little time up in this session because it's some of it's redundant from what we covered on the site visit.
Appreciate that.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name's Tom O'Connor. I'm one of the founding partners of SOSH Architects. We're based in New Jersey and New York. We've been fortunate over 30 years to do gaming properties, hospitality, and entertainment across the country. Caribbean and Europe. I personally think this is the most important part of the presentation, but that's because I'm an architect and we always think that way. I'm going to make it very brief and I'll take questions and go back to anything you want to revisit. We've been working with Parks for several years and we were fortunate enough to be asked by Parks to help them imagine a world-class destination entertainment resort. And what would that entertainment resort need? It would, first of all, have a casino that starts out at 3,000 slots and 170 table games with the ability to expand very quickly to an additional 1,750 slots. But as a world-class destination, what you're really looking at are the amenities that go along with that. Those amenities would include a 3,000-seat full performance theater, as well as banquet and entertainment, retail space, 8 branded restaurant and bar lounge venues, a rooftop pool club, spa, salon of about 12,000 square feet. As the hotel goes, we would start out with 250 guest rooms at about 450 to 500 square feet each, with the ability to add on another 200 guest rooms. Parking would start out with 4,000 self-park spaces, 1,000 employee valet spaces, and a bus transportation center. When we work with Parks, they said, we want to create and enforce the brand that we started in Philadelphia. Parks is very design-oriented, contemporary, cutting-edge design, exterior materials of glass, steel, and stone, coupled with what Parks loves, interactive video, signage / entertainment / lighting that you're going to see in a video that's going to follow this presentation. Go to the next slide, please. As you approach the Porte Cochere, this is something that Parks feels very strongly about, strong sense of arrival, again, glass, steel, a very strong design statement. This is a destination that you want to go to again and again. Next, please. This is your main approach to the property off of Old Fort Road. And again, our goal was to take the project and orient it out to Indian Head Highway and Old Fort Road as a statement of this is a fun entertainment location that just is an add-on to the enhancements to Maryland and the DC metro area. Next, please. Finally, this is how the project presents would be eventually under the master plan, the overpass, underpass master plan creation there at the intersection with the hotel tower acting as a welcome. A lot of the garage under and the bus transportation center under the casino with just a minimal amount of garage parking above that. But again, 5,000 space capacity. Next, please. This is the site plan, and to orient you, the top of the slide is Old Fort. Running top to bottom is Indian Head Highway, and as you can see, we've built on only and developed only 11 of the 26 acres, and we've been able to create, by the sandwiching of the garage and the casino, a very compact footprint on the site, preserving quite a bit of open space, water features, vegetation. A lot of what you saw on the site today is meant to stay there and be enhanced. Next, please. Basically, can we go back to that last slide just for a minute to orient everybody? What you're looking at is the casino in the center, number one, surrounded by the garage that's both below and above it. Off to the right-hand side is the hotel tower, number two. Down to the bottom is number three in the Lilac, which is the 3,000-seat entertainment theater. And as you can see how much open space there still is available there. Next, please. This is the ground level below the casino plan that lets allow for a capacity for 1,000 spaces plus a bus transportation center. You're going to see that in each of these plans, next please, there's the access from the garage and from the hotel to the casino is just an elevator stop away. Next slide, please. This is the main casino floor plan, and as you can see with the casino in the center, surrounded by the purple to both upper left-hand corner and towards the bottom, 8 branded food and beverage venues, along with high roller lounges, theater entrance off to the bottom right-hand corner. And if you look over to the left, there's built into this plan 72,000 square feet of shell space that can easily open up should the casino decide to expand to 4,750 slots. Next slide, please. Next slide is the actual mezzanine level above the casino, pre-function and theater area, poker area, and both back of house and future expansion capabilities. And the following slide is going to give you an idea of the typical layout of the self-park garage with speed ramps, the hotel off to the upper right-hand corner, 250 rooms to start with. That's a typical floor plan layout for the hotel. Next slide, please. Again, this is just going to be orienting you for the next series of, and what we're actually going to jump to here, I'm going to very quickly show you some interior vignettes. Parks is very famous for the level of fit, finish, and detail for the interiors of their properties. We've had, again, 30 years experience. I've never worked with a client that's put this level of emphasis on interiors. Next, please.
Let me ask a question on that most recent, the last slide, if you would. I see where you've got the future expansion on the right, top right, and then also the left. Is that already constructed, or would that require additional construction later on?
That's already constructed as shell space. It would just need to be fitted out with the interior finishes once they're ready to expand.
And what would its utilization be initially?
What would it initially be?
Yeah.
Initially, it would just be treated as shelled or temporary space for poker tournaments or something like that. It would not be completely fitted out as a casino space until they're ready to do their expansion.
Since we couldn't assume we had approval for more than 3,000 machines, we didn't present this with the full slot layout, but we could do that once we received approval. We'd be ready to go.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Next slide, please. These are some interior vignettes. This was the entry arrival courtyard as you come in the front door at the porte-cochere. Next slide, please. This gives you an idea of the level of detail. The property, this is the player's desk. You're going to see a lot of green in these slides. The park's properties address the level of sustainability with a lot of the materials that are used throughout the construction of the project. Next slide, please. This is one of the 8 branded food venues that occur throughout the property. Next slide, please. As you can see, they're very big on Windex. They're very big on glass in a lot of their venues. This is the center bar. And we could probably, at this point, go to the video to save some time here, if that's possible, jump to that.
That's a good idea.
You're basically driving down Old Fort Road, just coming off of Indian Head, approaching the entrance to the property.
The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war, and poverty. Wake up, all the teachers, talk to teachers. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say.